Series I've entitled Belonging, Living Together as a Part of the Body of Christ. And of course, that's being a part of the Church of Jesus Christ. We began by looking at what the Church is, the gathering of God's people together in Christ. We sang the song, Shout to the North and the South and Speak to the East and the West. Well, that comes from Isaiah. And that was a prophecy of what? Of the peoples from the north, south, east, and west, all coming together in Christ. The New Testament describes it as the vision of the heaven and seeing the people from every tribe and language and nation gathered together in Christ. Now we say tribe, language, and nation, that sounds like something from a long time ago. So if we said it in today's language, we say that there would be Puerto Ricans and Mexicans and Canadians and Southerners and Northerners and Yankees, Somalians and Syrians and Chinese and Indonesians, people who speak Spanish and Mandarin and German, all coming together into the body of Christ. That's what the Church is. That's what the Church is God bringing together the people of all nations and countries and languages together in Christ. And we're part of that great and glorious work of God, being a part of the body of Christ. We look at several aspects of that in the recent weeks. And last week I continued by looking that we are united in belief. And I looked at some of the core doctrines and teachings of Christianity and of Scripture. Today I want to continue with that by looking at Baptist distinctives. Now, Killarney is a Baptist church, and there are certain beliefs that characterize Baptists historically. Baptists began in the 1600s, of course, out of the Protestant Reformation, and they were a part originally of the Church of England. And so they were in England, John Smith and Thomas Helwys, and they're part of the Anglican Church. And they believed that reforms were needed and that changes were needed in order to bring the church more into alignment with the teachings of the New Testament because things had changed over time. And so some of the reformers in the Anglican Church wanted to stay in the church and change the church from within. And they're called Puritans. They wanted to purify the church. Others were called Separatists. That means they stepped out of the church. They formed their own congregations. And that's what Baptists were. They stepped away from the Church of England, the Anglican Church, and they began their own congregations. And they developed distinctives and doctrines. We'll look at that this morning and see what some of those things are. And it's done in the form of an acrostic, which you can find is pretty common in what Baptist beliefs are. And the first is biblical authority. The second is the autonomy of the local church. The third is the priesthood of the believer. Fourth is two ordinances. The I is individual soul liberty. The sixth is saved and baptized church membership. The T is two offices. And the S is the separation of church and state. And so we'll look at each of these individually, just kind of see this is our Baptist distinctives. Doesn't mean that others don't also practice these things or teach these things, but these are things that are characteristic of the Baptist churches. Biblical authority. Now, this is foundational to Baptist life. The reason that these early Baptists wanted to step out of the Church of England was they believed that the authority of the Church of England and the teachings were going beyond scriptural teaching. And so we all look for authority. And many times, authority in the church has relied on the church itself. And so denominationally, like the Roman Catholic Church, you have the Bible, but then you have a teaching of the church. They're considered equal. In many other churches where you don't have that, you may have the teaching of Scripture and the affirmation of Scripture, but a lot of times, well, what the fathers of the church, the pillars of the church say, well, that's what goes. And there's kind of a rule of the family or whoever it is in the church that kind of rules the church. So we have different areas of authority. It could be Scripture. It could be tradition. It could be a denomination. It can be culture. For many people, the authority is the culture. What do the cultural leaders say? That's our authority. And for just about everyone, it's me. I'm the authority. What I think is what's right. But Baptists have affirmed that the Bible is the highest authority in what we call our faith, our belief, and the practice of our faith. How we do that? The Bible says in 2 Timothy 3:15 through 17, you have been taught the holy scriptures from childhood, and they have given you the wisdom to receive the salvation that comes by trusting in Christ Jesus. How do we know about salvation? How do we know about Jesus? How do we know what Jesus said and did? We know it from Scripture. So Scripture is our authority because it testifies to Jesus Christ and to the revelation and the work of God throughout history. Verse 16 says, all Scripture is inspired by God and is useful to teach us what is true and to make us realize what is wrong in our lives. It corrects us when we're wrong and teaches us to do what is right. God uses it to prepare and equip His people to do every good work. So throughout the history of Baptist churches, the Word of God has been affirmed as the highest authority that is true and trustworthy in everything it teaches. And it teaches how to believe, what to believe, how to live our lives as followers of Christ. 1 Thessalonians 2:13 says this, therefore we never stop thanking God that when you received His message from us, you didn't think of our words as mere human ideas. You accepted what we said as the very Word of God, which of course it is. And this Word continues to work in you who believe. So we're founded on the authority of Scripture. 2 Peter 1, 20-21 says, above all, you must realize that no prophecy in Scripture ever came from the prophet's own understanding or from human initiative. Scripture wasn't made up by people. No, those prophets were moved by the Holy Spirit and they spoke from God. Biblical authority. The next part of the distinctives is autonomy of the local church. Now, there's no one Scripture passage or a passage of Scripture that defines explicitly how a church is to be governed. So you don't have one verse that says this is it or one passage that lays it out like a systematic theology. But in the New Testament, there's no formal hierarchical order above the local church and its overseers. And so throughout history, different churches have governed themselves in different ways and associated with other churches in different ways. Now in the early church, the church was normally associated with the city. So you have the church at Jerusalem. But now the church of Jerusalem wasn't the church at the corner of Via Della Rosa and Gethsemane Way. It was the church at Jerusalem, and it was made up of thousands, of tens of thousands of people. And the apostles were the overseers over that church, along with the elders of the church at Jerusalem. So the church can be very large and meet in many different places and be one church. So you have that happening in Jerusalem. Other places, there were smaller congregations as the church moved out. Like in Crete, Paul told Titus to appoint elders in each town. So still you had the church associated with a town. And you had, although there may just be a few people in that town, who made up that church in that town. And the elders were over that church, but they were to be unified together. Well, the church, of course, has developed different systems of government. One of those is called the episcopal system, and that means there's a bishop who's in charge, or a hierarchy of bishops. And those kinds of churches are the Roman Catholic Church, the Episcopal Church, the Anglican Church, and also the Methodist Church, where bishops are the ones who have an authority outside the local church, and that ruling over the church. Another kind is called the Presbyterian form of government, and that's what the Presbyterians have. And they send, you know, or elect elders and lay people to go to a synod or a session who have authority over the churches within their grouping. Baptist churches are congregational churches, and that means that the churches are autonomous, which means they're self-governing. So there's not a denomination or a structure outside of the church that rules or governs the church itself, but each church governs its own self, with the pastors and the deacons and the church itself having authority in making decisions. And so we have the autonomy of the local church and Baptist church faith and practice, and so there's an independence, but there's still cooperation. And so as Southern Baptists, we cooperate with tens of thousands of other Southern Baptist churches to do what? To do missions, to do help in the fight against world hunger, to start new churches, to train people in their theological and religious education. So we join together locally here in Orlando, across the state, across North America, and around the world to further the kingdom of God together as churches. So the autonomy of local church is another characteristic of Baptist churches. The next one is the priesthood of the believer. Now, this is something that most Protestants have been very strong in, for the most part, not 100%, but you know, the Roman Catholic Church has priests. And you go to a priest for confession, you go to a priest as an intermediary. And the Old Testament, there were priests. In the Old Testament, they had priests who were the ones that, on the Day of Atonement, the high priest went in to make a sacrifice on behalf of the sins of the people. They're the ones who served in the temple and offered the sacrifices on behalf of the people. Well, there are no priests in the New Testament because Jesus ended that. Jesus fulfilled the sacrificial system, and so they're no longer priests. And the way the New Testament talks about it is this. In 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 5, it says, "And you," speaking to the body of Christ, the believers, "are living stones that God is building into his spiritual temple." So the temple is no longer a building, but it's the people of God. Revelation says that God will what? Will dwell among his people as heaven and earth are united together. What's more, you are his holy priest. Through the mediation of Jesus Christ, you offer spiritual sacrifices that please God. So in the New Testament, there's one mediator between God and man, and that is the man, Jesus Christ. And all of us offer sacrifices of our lives, our praise, our worship, our giving unto God. All of us can come before God, into the presence of God, into the throne of God through the blood of Jesus Christ. When Christ died, the veil of the temple was torn in two. And we have access to the Father. So we don't have a priesthood because we're all priests. And our high priest is Jesus Christ. 1 Peter 2, 9 says, "But you are not like that, for you are a chosen people, you are a royal priest, a holy nation, God's very own possession. As a result, you can show others the goodness of God, for he called you out of the darkness into the light." The next thing is the two ordinances, and these are things that we're more familiar with, and we practice them regularly. In Matthew 28, 19, Jesus said, "Therefore, go and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit." Now, all Christians and all churches baptize. So what's the Baptist distinctive? Well, the Baptist distinctive is to baptize believers. Because in the New Testament, when they believed, then they were baptized. Early on in the Roman Catholic Church, they taught that an infant was lost in sin unless he or she was baptized. And so that infant had to be baptized to have their sins washed away so they wouldn't go into limbo and be in that odd kind of a place. The New Testament, we believe, teaches that a child is innocent until they come to an age of accountability. And when we come to that age of accountability, we profess our faith in Christ, we're baptized in obedience to Christ as a disciple of Christ, a follower of Christ. So Jesus commanded us to be baptized. We baptize believers who have professed faith in Christ. The next ordinance is the Lord's Supper. And Paul says in 1 Corinthians 11, "I pass on to you what I received from the Lord himself. On the night when he was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took bread, and he gave thanks to God for it. Then he broke it in pieces and said, 'This is my body, which is given for you. Do this to remember me.'" Now, Jesus was standing there with his disciples, and he had the bread, so this is my body. So he wasn't literally saying the bread was his physical body, because he was in his physical body. But it represents his body that was broken for us to pay the penalty for sin. "Do this," he says, "in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup of wine after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant between God and his people, an agreement confirmed with my blood. Do this to remember me as often as you drink." So Jesus commanded us to baptize those who come to faith in Christ. And he commanded us to share together in the Lord's Supper, which commemorates the death of Jesus Christ, through which we have atonement and forgiveness of sin. All right, the next one. Individual soul liberty. Now, that may be something you may not have heard of before. But this has to go with the priesthood, the authority of the church, and those kinds of things. And it has to do with the idea of a person having the competency, the ability and responsibility to respond to God. And that each of us can respond to God in faith, in repentance, in obedience. And we don't have to go through an intermediary. And there's no intermediary who controls our lives. Some churches can get very, very legalistic. And people within the church can seek to control the conscience and the lives of other people out of a sense of authority. And this is one of the things that Baptists faced. Historically, the reason Baptists were persecuted oftentimes because they weren't submitting to higher authorities in their faith and practice. Romans chapter 14 talks about this freedom and responsibility that we have as individuals. Now, having soul liberty doesn't mean that I can do anything I want to do. All right? It doesn't mean I can believe anything I want to believe and anything I say is true or right. We still look to Scripture as the foundation of that authority. But Paul says in Romans 14, 5 to 12, because the church was fighting about things and disagreeing about things. He says, in the same way, some think one day is more holy than another day, while others think that every day is alike. You should each be fully convinced that whichever day you choose is acceptable. It's about your conscience. So there's some things in Scripture that are explicit in the New Testament that we believe and do. Other things aren't explicit, and many times we decide how we will do those things. And so he goes on, and he says, those who worship the Lord on a special day do it to honor Him. Those who eat any kind of food do so in the honor to honor the Lord, since they give thanks to God before eating. And those who refuse to eat certain foods also want to please the Lord and give thanks to Him. They had rules about what day you could worship. They had rules about what food you could eat. And he says that these are matters of conscience. He says, for we don't live for ourselves or die for ourselves. If we live, it's to honor the Lord. And if we die, it's to honor the Lord. So whether we live or die, we belong to the Lord. Christ died and rose again for this very purpose, to be the Lord both of the living and the dead. So this is putting the lordship of Christ as first and preeminent. Christ taught his disciples not to lord it over the people, because those who lord their authority seek to control people's lives. Do not lord it over them. He says, Christ died and rose again for this very purpose, to be Lord both of the living and the dead. So why do you condemn another believer? Why do you look down on another believer? Remember, we will all stand before the judgment seat of God. For the Scriptures say, as surely as I live, says the Lord, every knee will bend to me, and every tongue will declare allegiance and praise to God. Yes, each of us will give a personal account to God. So we're all accountable to God, directly accountable to God, and God gives us the grace to be able to respond to Him in faith, to be able to respond to Him in repentance, to be able to respond to Him in obedience. So we have that. The next part of the Baptist thing is a saved, baptized church. It says in Acts 2:41, those who believe what Peter said were baptized and added to that church that day about 3,000 in all. So this is, who is the church? Well, the church was who? Those who believed in the gospel, were baptized in obedience to Christ, and were added to the church. We call that regenerate church membership. The members of the church are people who have placed their faith in Christ, followed Christ in baptism, and been added to the church. Now, and that's it. Why is that distinctive? Because in other faiths, children who do not profess faith in Christ are members of the church because they have been baptized as infants. And so Baptists don't accept that as biblical teaching. And so we believe that to be a part of the church, individually we must repent. Individually we must place our faith in Christ, follow Him in baptism as in obedience to Him, and then we are part of the fellowship of believers in a local church. Next one is two offices. The two offices we see, we mentioned those last week as well, Philippians 1:1. This letter is from Paul and Timothy, slaves of Christ Jesus. I'm writing to all of God's holy people in Philippi who belong to Christ Jesus, including the elders and deacons. And so it comes to the officers or the rulers of the church. This goes back to congregational government. And in the scripture, the offices are one, the overseers, elders or pastors, we talked about that last week, and then also the deacons who are ministry leaders, servant leaders. The first and most explicit thing we see referring to that kind of ministry would be when the feeding of the poor in Acts. And the apostles said, we need somebody to take care of this ministry. Choose six, you know, godly, spirit-filled men to come and take this place and to do this ministry. So those are the two offices of the church, the elders and the deacons. And the elders, as I said before, is the same word for bishop, pastor, elder, is the same office in the local church. And then the last thing here is the separation of church and state. And this is very, very important. The First Amendment to the Constitution of the United States was written in cooperation with Baptists. Baptists were in communication with Thomas Jefferson in writing that amendment. Why? Because Baptists were persecuted. And why are Baptists persecuted? Because the church combined itself with the state. And that had happened for hundreds, even thousands of years, where there's an official state church. And that means they decide what is right doctrine and right practice, and they force everyone to obey those doctrines and practices through the authority and the power of the state. Now that leads to corruption. A lot of the corruption and the evil and the wrong that took place in Europe over the centuries in associated Christianity is because the church and the state became united together. And Baptists do not believe that the church and the state should be combined together. Now, when you have a lot of influence and a lot of power, then there's temptation. We want to be in charge. We want to tell people what to believe and what to do. But God didn't set up the church to be in control of the state. There's two different spheres of authority. Now, the state is accountable to God. All people are accountable to God and be obedient to God. Whether you're a Christian or not a Christian, we're still accountable to God. And so the state has a role, and it says in Scripture, to what? To punish evil, to reward good, to bring justice and the rule of law in a nation. Jesus said in Matthew 22:21, give to Caesar what belongs to Caesar, and give to God what belongs to God. They're asking about taxes. Do we pay taxes? They're saying, we're followers of you. We're part of your kingdom. Why should we pay taxes to another king, to another kingdom? He says, you give to Caesar what belongs to him, you give to God what belongs to God. He recognized those two spheres that were there coexisting together. When Jesus stood before Pilate, he said, my kingdom is not an earthly kingdom. Now, many Christians have tried to make the kingdom of God an earthly kingdom. And that's where the state and the church combine together. But he says, my kingdom is not an earthly kingdom. If it were, my followers would fight to keep me from being handed over to the Jewish leaders. But my kingdom is not of this world. And so Baptists believe in a separation of church and state. In the United States, Massachusetts Bay Colony was a church-state colony. The state and church were combined there, and the Baptists were persecuted for not following the doctrines of the state church, and they had to flee. One of those is Roger Williams, who went to Rhode Island and started a Baptist church in Rhode Island. So the separation of church and state grew out of the idea of soul competency, the priesthood of the believer, freedom of conscience, faithfulness to God's word, and not having the state dictate religious belief and conscience. And then Acts 5:27-29. The apostles, of course, were preaching the gospel. They healed a man who was lame at the temple. And the authorities, the state authorities of that time, the Sanhedrin, were angry because of the people following this other faith, this other religion, this other Messiah. And so then they brought the apostles before the high council, where the high priest confronted them. He said, we gave you strict orders never again to teach in this man's name. Instead, you have filled all Jerusalem with your teaching about him, and you want to make us responsible for his death. But Peter and the apostles replied, "We must obey God rather than any human authority." What does that mean? That means there's a separation between the state and the church. The state is human authority, accountable to God. But the church is distinct from that. And so we are to live our faith as Christians. And it can be very tempting to use the power of the state to try to accomplish the work of the church. But we lose the power of the Holy Spirit and the power of God to transform lives when church and state are put together. We have to be careful not to try to use the state, the government, to do what God's called us to do as the church of Jesus Christ. Because what God is doing is something the state can do. You see, the state can't make somebody a Christian. They tried in the past to do that. There's no authority. Even your parents can't make you a Christian. Being a Christian is something that happens in our hearts through our response to the Holy Spirit, to the Word of God, as we hear the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ, and we respond with faith. We respond by turning to God in faith and repentance and obedience to Him, and we're saved and we follow Him. And so these are our things that are distinctive to Baptists, and many of these you may have been familiar with, other ones maybe not so familiar with, but we believe that these are biblical principles to follow. And so these are parts of our tradition in the practice of the Baptist Church. So I wanted to share those things because those are kind of things that unite us together. Now, it doesn't mean that there's only one way to see all these things. There can be debate about these things, especially church government. There's some debates on those things. But these are the things that have distinguished Baptists throughout history. And in trying to look at the church, things that are happening in the church, and in seeking to return to a more New Testament and biblical form of church, a church life. And I pray that you, as followers of Christ here in Killarney, be committed to the authority of Scripture and put Scripture above traditions, above preferences, above what I want, above what we used to do, above what they do, and say, God, we just want to know what you say, what you want us to do, and we want to prioritize what you've prioritized in Scripture. And we want to put that first in our lives. We want to be a part of seeing people, all kinds of people, coming together in the body of Christ. We've been given the ministry of reconciliation, reconciling people to God. And that's what we want to be a part of, bringing people together, united together in our faith and our obedience to Jesus Christ.